Here's Ed Bernstein.
Hi, welcome to our show. My guests today are Gary Chapman and Cassie Chapman, and country star, reality stars, singer, songwriters, Hooters girl.
That's right.
Right?
Indeed.
And
Hall of Fame Hooters girl.
And now advocates for adoption. I have so much to talk to you two about that I don't really know where to start. Maybe I'll start with...
Anywhere's fine.
Let me start with the serious stuff first, and maybe a little bit later on, Gary, I can get you to sing a little song
or
something.
If you want it, I'll sing it.
I mean, you're a man of many talents, and that's one that we all want to hear.
Thanks.
But you've made a lot of news lately, particularly on the reality show, mm-hmm. About adopting a child. Now, everybody has different experiences, some very positive, some very negative, mm-hmm. about adoption.
Sure.
Right? Obviously, a sensitive issue for a lot of people. You have children, other children?
I have three children from a previous marriage. I have a son, 27. Okay. I have two daughters, 24 and 21, living in Manhattan, mm-hmm. and a one-year-old. Yes.
So what was it like for you, Gary? You have grown children,
right.
And look, I have, I was 40 years old when I had my first child, so I kind of get
right.
some of this. And I have three daughters and three stepdaughters. And I know that, it doesn't matter how well you raise your children, when you 20, 25 years later, you think back and say, damn, I could have done a better
exactly.
job. Right?
That's exactly it.
Yeah.
You know, life is a series of, if I'd only known then what I know now, moments, basically.
Right.
And, I was a good father. I really enjoyed my kids. We had a lot of fun, my first three. We traveled a lot, we laughed a lot, but I was an idiot. I was distracted with my own, passions and drives, and it's just a very different experience. My time with Eva Rose is, and I don't say this as any slight to my older kids, they know, good grief, mm-hmm. they know me well. It's just different. It is, every moment is so precious. It is a great thing. I'm not sure we shouldn't all just wait until we're about 50 to have kids.
Well,
maybe
I was going to bring that up. I mean, guys in their
20s,
they're narcissistic.
Idea. They're idiots.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So give me one example of something that you intend to do differently.
The big one is time. That's awfully mm-hmm. general. That's not a specific thing, but that is the big overriding piece of it for me is time.
Right.
It's not enough to just touch the base on the special moments and rush out the door and I'll see you later, honey. Although that's going to happen time to time because you got to eat, stay alive. But, waking up in the middle of the night, I mean, when she was, an infant, I volunteered for the 3 a.m. feeding.
I did.
And absolutely loved it. It was just... Mm-hmm. the best.
Good bonding time.
Oh my gosh, I mean, that's it's priceless. It really is priceless. When you realize that those moments are priceless, you actually treat them as that. You treasure them and you kind of hoard them a little bit, That's the big one, is time.
Don't take it for granted. I know when you have your first child, it's like you can't wait for the next developmental stage in mm-hmm. a child's life. Okay, they're crawling. Okay, I can't wait for them to
see,
walk.
I, wanted
I can't
to
wait.
Slow.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. That's what. That's
and
my
I'm
point.
And
now it's like, okay, let's
exactly.
freeze time. Right.
Yep. That's what I'm trying to do.
It's much different. So I mean, there's a lot of.
So we've got her weighted down, so she can't actually stand up straight. No.
Yeah. Right.
Oh, is she walking?
No,
yeah.
She's running everywhere.
Running. Okay.
Yeah.
Because now you regret. Now you got to
yeah.
keep a leash on them. Right.
Exactly.
And climbing. That's
yeah.
her new thing.
Yeah. Yeah. I learned it's much easier when before they can walk. Keep your eye on. But there's a lot of ways to adopt. There's a lot of ways to. Why did you choose adoption instead of like other fertility or in vitro procedures?
Yeah, that's the deal. We were, for part of the show, our journey was going to be IVF because, he had a vasectomy after his third child, and 18 years later, we are going to try to have a baby.
I put the boys back in the pool.
Yes, that's his
which is harder
line.
Than taking them out, just for granted.
So we wanted to try naturally after that was done, and unsuccessful, so we decided to go down the IVF path. And it was a late November evening, and it was like 9:30 at night, and I get a call from our real estate agent, mm-hmm. randomly enough, who is a good friend. But she said, now I know you guys are going down the IVF path, but how do you feel about adoption? Well, I've always wanted to adopt. So I was like, yes. He was sitting right beside me, not knowing.
All I hear on this phone call is, yeah, sure.
Okay.
Okay, that sounds good. She hangs up and goes, so what do you think about adoption? I said, you know what? There's a lot of kids that need a home, and yeah. I got no problem with that.
And I said, good, we're meeting the birth mother on Friday. And he's like, okay.
Okay, good enough.
And was that a weird experience? I mean, you've had a positive experience with the birth mother.
Yes.
I mean, it can go the other way as well, right?
Yep.
I mean, so, and you must be really nervous to meet that person because, A, you want to make sure that it's an appropriate person to be the birth mother for mm-hmm. you, and secondarily, you're kind of like auditioning for the job.
You are. Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I had a whole packet full of family photos and our biographies, and she didn't care. She was just like, she became my sister, really. It's just that kind of bond, and we love her dearly.
Yeah, every situation is different. In ours,
yes, that's true.
I mean, it will remain open. You know, if she goes off the deep end and becomes a crazy person, then obviously we can control mm-hmm. that amount. But I don't foresee that at all. She's a great person, and I really wouldn't want to keep her out of the baby's life. But it's different. We kind of hit the jackpot. We know it.
And when you anticipate keeping the birth mother in your baby's life, you know, at some age you have to communicate that to your
sure.
to your daughter, right?
Oh yeah.
So, I mean, what do the experts say? When do you do that?
We don't listen to them.
That?
It's every situation is different. Mm-hmm. Every adoption story is different. She'll know as soon as she can understand. This is Chelsea. This is your birth mother, and she loved you enough, and she couldn't afford to take care of you the way that she wanted. So she picked us to raise you, mm-hmm. and that's the story. I mean,
so she's the hero.
Yeah.
So when you go through a private adoption, I mean, most people don't have the resources that the two of you have to adopt. I mean, that obviously was a benefit.
You know what? Oddly enough, the path that we chose was much, much, and money's not actually the object at that point, but it actually was much, much cheaper than it would have been had we gone the path through a state agency. And this is no slam to the world.
We're showing some video
it's
now.
So cute.
Yeah, there she is. She's so sweet.
She's so big now.
Good grief! I can't believe how tiny she was there. You go through a state agency, and I don't know what it's like here in Nevada.
Nevada.
Thank you.
Man,
I mean,
Nevada.
We always fight.
Nevada.
I'm there now.
Yeah. Okay. You think of the word ad.
Thank you.
And it's Nevada.
I don't know what it's like here, but as a general rule, most of the time when you get, you know, the government or a bureaucracy involved, it's going to take longer and it's going to cost more.
Right.
And that certainly is the case with adoption. And granted, you could have a few bad experiences along that path, and it might wind up costing the same. I don't know, but if you're careful. And you really listen to your heart, and you really pay attention along the way at every little piece. You know, is your lawyer an idiot or not? You know,
that's the key. Get a great attorney.
Is this person a flake? You know, talk to their family.
So what did you do? Check, you know, references and.
Oh sure.
How did you go about doing that?
Well, luckily the friend that called us originally about the whole situation. Her son is the birth father, so we knew.
She didn't know it at the time.
Oh. Yeah,
which makes for great drama.
Oh, yeah.
But it was, you know, we knew her and that whole family, and we love them dearly. So we knew that was a go.
Very sorry.
And then we met Chelsea's family, and they're sweet, sweet humans. Mm-hmm. So it was cool.
And what happened first? The reality show was going on first,
we were in the audition process.
Yeah, we were. Audition/negotiating when that all started happening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And yeah.
So then it became, oh, this is a great little subplot. Right?
Oh, it's awesome.
Yeah.
It's a great storyline. Yeah.
It became my storyline.
Yeah.
Right. But then you had to be a little bit secretive about it because real life was not catching up with television.
That was weird. It was just so weird. And
I had to hide my daughter for 9 months.
Yeah, we've got this beautiful, fabulous kid. Right. Obviously, our family knows, our close friends know. Right. We're public creatures, and Nashville's a small town, so you know we're out and about with this fabulous little redheaded baby.
But I couldn't post pictures on social media of my daughter.
Yeah.
I'm just like, really?
But it's okay. It didn't last that long.
And then was the birth mother a participant?
Yes.
Or were you a participant with her during the pregnancy, with the doctor's
visits?
I mean, you did that whole stereotypical thing.
We got to
thing.
Be there for the gender ultrasound. We were there.
And did you know it was a girl?
Yeah.
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 Okay, right away.
Yeah.
We actually named her Eva Rose before we knew she had red hair. So when she came out, I was like, oh, awesome. Great.
Her mother has red hair?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And then... you know, we got to stay in the hospital. We were two doors down from Chelsea, the birth mother, and we originally were going to be able to be in the room with her, but she had to have an emergency C-section.
Right. But
we still have the pictures from literally being born.
Yep. Yep.
And then got to go in the nursery as soon as she got there. It was a really wonderful emotional roller coaster.
The baby comes home from the hospital with us.
Yeah.
Wait, was that, okay, but before the baby comes home, you're in the hospital, the birth mother just, you know, had a C-section, delivered the child, and now it's like, okay, it's time to leave.
It's an emotional minefield.
How was that for her?
Yeah. It was really, really hard because I was so close to Chelsea that I was feeling really bad for her. Yes.
A little guilty about it? Yeah.
It wasn't guilt. It was just my heart was breaking for her because she's a wonderful lady and a great family. And I just, you know, she thought that we were going to get all the joy. And I'm like, I don't have any joy right now because I feel so sad for you. And we're taking your child home. That was my mentality at that point. It was just, it was heartbreaking.
That was actually a great question, though. I've never considered the fact that guilt was there, but it almost feels that way. It's like taking something that didn't originally belong to you, despite the fact that somebody's giving it to you. But, you know, that's true in a whole bunch of life. We all get blessings.
And sometimes accepting something is not easy.
No, it's not.
Especially something as dear as that.
Yeah.
I mean, what greater a gift can anybody give you?
Oh, it's the most selfless gift a human can give.
Yeah.
Okay, so while this is all going on, you have TV cameras filming this, right?
Yes.
Now, how awkward was that?
Well, after the emotional roller coaster at being at the hospital, we get the baby, and as soon as we're leaving the hospital, they're in your face, cameras are in our car.
Oh, yeah, we have five cameras in the car on the way home, so...
Okay. So secure the cameras at the mirrors and
everywhere, yes.
Right? Right. So do you have somebody in the car with you also holding
the
camera?
No, we had audio in the back.
Uh-huh.
He was ducked in the back, but
you know.
Yeah, where are the microphones, by the way?
Yeah, they were on.
They hide them fairly well.
But
they're on.
Yeah. And then, we get home. First time mom, obviously I don't have a clue what I'm doing.
Uh-oh.
And so I have no idea how to work the diaper genie, so I'm sitting there trying to work things. It was just hilarious, but.
Well, you do and you don't. Having kids is, you can read and you can think and you can talk to your friends and you study and you do all this stuff, but until you actually get your hands on it, literally, you don't really know what you're doing. I had the advantage of having, three kids previously.
But yeah, it was a long time ago. Forgot how to do the diaper thing?
Actually, that's a bicycle. That comes right back to you. That does. But as far as the cameras go, for my part, it was a non-event. I've just been, around them my whole life, and I just don't think about it. I don't.
I made a choice
a long time ago to just absolutely be honest and clear every time. If I'm on camera or not, but certainly on camera, because if you don't, you're going to pay for it at some point.
Right.
And the camera's going to see, and nothing reads your soul like a camera. It knows if you're yanking somebody's chain. You know it. You've been in this chair a long time.
Yeah, but and I know that that you are an honest man, and you're very clear and transparent,
right?
But still, you have a camera there. I mean, there's a little bit of playing to the camera. I mean, you know you're being viewed.
Well,
watched.
You're exactly right. But I think I play to the camera all the time. I'm the guy that's always looking for the next little punchline or the next, you know, moment to, right, to yeah. make somebody giggle. I would do that if the camera's there or not. So it is, in that sense, the same.
We'll be right back to have some more conversation with Gary and Cassie Chapman after this message. And you're going to play something.
I'd love to.
I love it. Okay, right back. Accidents don't discriminate. They can happen anywhere to anybody. It really comes down to results.
Enough said. Call Ed.
I'm Ed Bernstein, and I've been getting those results for nearly 40 years.
EdBernstein.com.
We're back with Gary and Cassie Chapman, and your husband's about to play for us, but I mean, you get to hear this all the time, right?
Oh, it's awesome. And what's really cool is Eva Rose is now singing along with him. He'll be playing in the great room, and she'll just get up there. Rah! She can't speak, of course, but she loves to sing.
How about you? Do you have musical ability?
Yes, in the shower. Excellent shower singer.
Okay. Okay, Gary, are you ready over there?
I am indeed.
Okay, Gary Chapman.
I've learned more from my mistakes than I ever did from doing something right. Every wrong turn I take showed me one more way to fly or sometimes fight. And all that flying and the fighting showed me who to trust and who to just let go. Every stupid thing I've done so far has taught me nearly everything I know. Till your back's against the wall, you will never know how powerful you are. Till you're down to your last call, and you're wishing on that lonely, lucky star. And on the path of least resistance, you are gonna miss some gorgeous, bumpy roads. Every stupid thing I've done so far has taught me nearly everything I know. Truth is sometimes better left unspoken, and that love will always see right through a lie. A heart grows back much better where it's broken, and what don't kill you makes you stronger unless you die. You could fill a million books with the stuff that I know now but didn't then. And with all the times I failed, but then turned right round and did the same again. But the good Lord stood beside me. Never once did he forget he loves me so. Used every stupid thing so far to teach me nearly everything I know. To always leave the door of my heart open, in spite of what I know might blow inside. When there is no way out, to just keep hoping, and to keep on never knowing till I've tried. I've learned more from my mistakes than I ever did from doing something right.
Yay!
Thank you.
Wow.
I love that one.
He has a new album, right? Truth?
Yes, The Truth. Yeah,
the truth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This song is on it?
It is.
What is the title of this song?
That's called Everything I Know.
Everything I know, I wrote down a couple of the lines, because to me it was like poetry.
I hope so.
Yeah, it was. The words and lyrics are just amazing. Every stupid thing I've done has taught me everything I know.
Yeah.
You know, it's like when things happen, we do stupid things, bad things happen to us. And then we think that this is a huge mistake. But it's never really a mistake, is it, Gary?
You know, it is and it isn't. And depending on how you respond to the realization that you've just screwed up is what redeems it or solidifies it as being a mistake. If you admit it and you own it and you reflect and learn, then it wasn't. It was supposed to happen all along.
You believe that everything, that who you are today, how you feel today, what your life is today, was supposed to happen, and based on
I do.
Everything that did occur has brought you to where you are now.
I actually do believe that.
You want to give that guitar to somebody to hold?
It's okay. I'm comfy with it, but thank you.
Yeah, I mean, it's and then I love this other line: "A heart grows back better when it's broken."
Yeah, you know,
scar tissue.
They always say that, you know, about when you break a bone, it actually is stronger at that point than anywhere else, and that has been true with me. It has. I think when you get your butt handed to you, heart-wise, if you own your part of it and forgive and move on past it, you will be stronger and better. I hope so. I mean, the problems and the issues that I've had relationship-wise in my life have all made me ready for her.
Yep. See,
and
the benefit of
it is.
Prior girlfriends and wives.
It is.
Yep. And vice versa.
Yeah, I have some video of your reality show. Real Housewives of Private Lives of Nashville Wives. It's a tongue twister. Private Lives of Nashville Wives.
That's right.
It's an ironic name, too, since they put it on national television.
Everybody has their own little cliques.
Oh, Betty.
We are Cuban-American identical twins.
Did you kiss her?
I just want to know.
We did earlier.
Go find me a stick. I'm going to beat my sister.
She's actually what I call a fun sponge.
I'd make out with every person's husband here.
Betty, are you on Brent's lap?
Yeah.
I've got another leg.
Ooh, here I go.
I feel left out.
I'm a former TV soap star.
I'm married to Brian White, successful singer-songwriter. For the past 10 years, I've been a stay-at-home mom.
I'm finally hitting that point that it's okay to put a little focus on me.
Nashville can be pretty ruthless.
What are y'all doing tonight?
We've seen so many friends come and go.
Yeah, isn't it crazy? The roller coaster that we go through.
Does Dallas ever come to see you on the road?
He's always traveling. I'm always traveling. We just cannot get along.
My God, I could lose the love of my life.
Being married to someone in entertainment, his job is to flirt. I would be a fool to be jealous.
This is fascinating.
I went from being a Hooters girl to marrying Mr. Gary Chapman, legendary Christian singer-songwriter.
It's amazing what people say about me. She's a gold digger.
I value my marriage too much.
That is just bull and you know it.
Really? Are these people for real?
Oh my God.
You're a very abrasive person. What's up with you?
I've been told that I'm intimidating. I don't see that.
Are you not eating?
No.
You skinny bitches never eat.
You're a pusher. You push for what you want to hear.
I just hope that she can take it as well as she dishes it.
I'm really sorry.
Zip it.
Erica, don't you know? Nobody likes skinny girls who think they're fat. Definitely nobody likes ultra-gorgeous soap opera stars.
Like, is she just trying to attack me?
She's grilling me.
You know, it's so fun to watch that back.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, every reality show seems to have, quote, the mean girl in it. I mean, your background is, you're a cheerleader and very accomplished cheerleader, right?
Yes.
And we were talking on the break about how the athletic ability that cheerleaders really need. Were you a flyer?
Oh, yes, of course.
Oh, you're the one that gets tossed up there.
30 feet into the air.
I have a video I made 2 weeks ago of her doing, what's that called?
A back tuck.
A back tuck.
Mm-hmm. But you still do it?
Oh, yeah.
She can nail that sucker. Yeah.
I love it. Anyway, so is that your role on, or your personality on this show? Are you the rah-rah cheerleader type?
I would guess yes. They refer to me as Switzerland because, honestly, I cannot stand to be in drama. So I just look at Jen, for instance, and I'm like, shut up. Erica, stop crying. I just put it out there.
She's the middle.
Yes.
Yeah.
And how did the show come about? Did you need to audition for it? Did people come and approach you? How did that work?
Yeah, I was approached 3 times and said no all 3 times because I was like, I'm not going to subject my family to that type of scrutiny, really. And then the 4th lady came to me and she's like, let's just sit down and talk about it. And so we really just sat down and prayed and said, you know, if this is what he wants us to do, then the door will open, and here we are.
And did you know the other couples prior?
He knew the husbands.
Yeah, I knew most of the guys.
Was there in the music business?
Most of them, yeah. And I'd known most of them for quite a while. The wives did not.
We were all 1 degree from each other, but never hung out.
So is there a lot of competition and pettiness and jealousy?
With the twins, yes, because, you know, they're identical twins and they fight.
Mm-hmm. All the time.
All the time.
It's hilarious.
So you never know what you're going to get. It's not that,
you know, we've pulling drunken brawl kind of housewife show, but you get 6 women together, you're going, and this is not a sexist statement. It's just the
different truth.
Yeah. You're going to get drama. It's going to happen. So, yeah, that happened.
Okay, we have another clip, I think. Yes? Okay, let me show another clip.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Cassie Chapman with Private Lives of Nashville Wives, and this is my closet. Bargain shopper, 100%. Mama likes her heels. I have to have a platform in everything I wear. That could be because I have a short complex. I get these at antique shops, and these are called stoles, and I have one pretty much in every color. Is that raccoon or squirrel? I don't know. As you can see, I have a collection of clutches. Fancy, fancy. Definitely a hat girl. This one in particular is my absolute favorite. It's a little loud, but I love it because it was my grandfather's.
Well, it looks like an interesting show. Lots of shoes, of course. Fun. Women, their shoes.
That's right.
Gary, Cassie, I want to thank you both very much. I could have gone on for another half an hour with this, but, you know, best of luck with your adoption.
Thank you so much. You got
any plans to adopt a second?
We really have started talking about it. Yeah, why not?
Okay. when you do that, maybe we'll come back and have another chat. And we'll see you next week. Thank you very much, Gary.